Tosca by Puccini. A shabby little shocker, wrote musicologist Joseph Kerman. A Parisian critic wrote, after its 1900 opening, that Tosca is coarsely puerile, pretentious, and vapid. And yet, Puccini's Tosca is one of the 10 most popular operas in the entire repertoire. There aren't many operas that manage to kill off all the principal characters by the end, but that's exactly what happens in Tosca, a wonderfully two, with one knifing, one firing squad, and a sudden suicidal leap. Of all operas, the appeal of the story is a major one. The plot is a simple one of love and jealousy. Cavaradossi is an idealist and almost everything we want in our romantic hero. Scarpia is the villain with no redeeming features, and a woman called Tosca, caught between the two. Tosca is Puccini's fifth opera. At its premiere in Rome in 1900, certain commentators were excessively harsh towards the work, calling it a minor melodrama with some fine music. These hostile reviews were perhaps based on the fact that the opera speaks to our primal instincts, something which must have seemed shocking at the time. Blood, all-consuming passion between two lovers, torture, the struggle between power and sex, sadism. And in the background, jealousy, the Napoleonic Wars, and politics. Puccini's Tosca is based on a play by French playwright Victorien Sardou, La Tosca, written for the era's great tragedian, the most magnetic of French, or perhaps even international actresses, Sarah Bernhardt. Puccini had seen a performance of La Tosca in Florence in 1889, when Bernhardt was on tour in Italy. La Tosca seemed to be the perfect vehicle for the great actress, with its interesting political, cultural, and social context. The context? Rome in 1800, following the victory of Bonaparte's troops at the Battle of Marengo. The protagonist? Artists, and therefore liberals, who saw Napoleon as their savior. And the antagonist? Scarpia, the Roman chief of police, on the side of the royalists. In the play, Scarpia spends most of his time imprisoning and torturing anyone who resists or opposes him. The word revolution drives him crazy. Sardou's play was written at the end of the 19th century and was part of the naturalist movement. Sardou, as a real history buff who filled his plays with historical references, tried to reproduce historical reality as accurately as possible. For instance, in Tosca. Tosca is an orphan raised by the Benedictines, who taught her how to sing, like Vivaldi did in his time. Tosca's voice teacher was the real composer Cimarosa. And the play, we must say, is well done. The props, including a fan, the painting, the knife, the letters, were real. And the character's ambitions were clearly set out, a Tosca passionately in love, an intellectual, sadistic, and violent police chief. When Puccini took on Sardou's play, he tightened up the work, cutting Sardou's 5 acts and 22 characters down to 3 acts and 9 characters. Puccini focused the action on the passionate love between Tosca and Mario, and on Scarpia's demonic power. So, what is Tosca all about? An idealistic painter and a famous diva in love with one another, and a twisted and sadistic police chief in love with the same woman. The story takes place in 3 acts. The first act is set in Rome in 1800 in the midst of the Neapolitan Wars. The diva Tosca and the painter Mario Cavaradossi are deeply in love with one another. She's jealous. He is an idealistic, pro-revolution painter who is hiding a political prisoner, Angelotti. Angelotti is being sought by Scarpia, the chief of police, who rages at everything having to do with the revolution. In the second act, Scarpia arrests Mario, charging him with complicity and torturing him to find out where Angelotti is being hidden. But it is Tosca who finally reveals the location and who manages to kill the police chief, who had tried to seduce her, after having obtained a safe conduct to free Mario. And in the third act, and third and final act, Mario's mock execution turns out to have been a real one. Mario is killed and the diva commits suicide rather than letting herself get caught by Scarpia's henchmen. Tosca's music is very efficient. Firstly, through its concern for authenticity. For the Te Deum that brings the first act to a close, for example, Puccini asked the Roman friend to send him the exact melody of the Gregorian Te Deum. He also made his way to Rome to listen to the bells at daybreak in the area near the Castel Sant'Angelo, which he then used as a musical introduction to the third act. The music is also efficient because it knows how to be expedient and sudden, like a film score that reacts to the slightest shift in the story. Oddly, the main characters have few arias. Tosca has but one aria, and Mario only has 2 short ones. We get the feeling that Puccini scaled back the big lyrical moments to allow for more nervous, heightened action. Tosca premiered in Rome in 1900. The audience loved it, but the critics hated it, condemning the violence and the orchestration. But for 110 years, Tosca has defied the critics and continues to reign as the grande dame of opera. The Opéra de Montréal presents Puccini's Tosca with Melody Moore as Tosca, Giancarlo Monsalve in the role of Mario, and Gregory Dahl as Scarpia. Italian conductor Giuseppe Grazioli leads the Orchestre Métropolitain and the Opéra de Montréal chorus in a co-production by Cincinnati Opera and the ODM.